Okay, good evening. I'm very sorry that David couldn't be with you, and apologies have been sent in many forms. I hope I can keep to the timings this evening. Due to the circumstances, I haven't had chance to rehearse this as well as I might, so I'll be aiming for 45 minutes, but you'll just have to forgive me if I'm a little faster or a little slower. I joined NRI on the 1st of April as the reader in Behavioural Entomology, and have been working prior to that in Sweden and in Africa on pests and on vectors of disease. So, why insect behaviour? Insects have been involved in mankind's struggle for existence as far back as we can go. Pestilence, war, famine, and death are the riders of the apocalypse, and insects work influencing famine by destroying the foodstuffs and livestock, and they also directly influence us by transmitting a range of diseases. It's one of those things that in this day and age we're all very aware of the outbreak of Ebola. That isn't insect transmitted. That's killed in the region of 7,000 to 8,000 people at the moment. During the time since its outbreak, malaria will have killed around 400,000 people. Hunger, an unaccountable number. So, to run through a little on some of the serious problems that we face that are linked to insect behaviour. Anopheles gambiae, the mosquito that's the vector of malaria, has been described by some as the most dangerous animal in the world. While Australians talk about killing sharks by the hundred after the death of a number of bathers, Anopheles gambiae is still vectoring malaria, and in sub-Saharan Africa, it's estimated that 40% of the children under 10 years of age have malaria, are suffering from malaria, and in any given year, the estimates are that somewhere between 500,000 and 900,000 will die of malaria. At the same time, there are other insects vectoring disease both to humans and to livestock. The tsetse fly, on which NRI, long before I joined them, had done some marvellous work, transmits in a belt over Central Africa. The extremity of the disease in livestock can be so great that there are no draft animals, so that people are having to do their ploughing, pulling the ploughs themselves. And this has long been a problem. Personally, I've not worked with tsetse fly, but it's so part of the culture that a friend of mine in the Royal Engineers is in a unit whose symbol is a traction engine. And it's because the unit was formed to take steam power to South Africa in the Boer War, because all the mules were dying and all the oxen were dying because of sleeping sickness and the transmission. In terms of crop losses, I've just pulled a single example out, but there are a myriad of examples. In Kenya, around 15% of the maize harvest is destroyed by the maize stem borers. That's the equivalent of getting up towards 500,000 tons of maize. Some farmers lose nearly half their crop. And work with insects is looking at the behaviour of these pests to see how we can look into these problems and how we can solve them for the farmers. The area where insect behaviour is most appropriate is perhaps in what are called push-pull systems. And these are used in both cropping systems and with livestock. And you're looking at a system where you've got two parts. First, to try and distract or drive the insect away from the crop or from the livestock, and also that you're trying to complement that with making it that there's somewhere that the insects are drawn to. In the case of maize and the stem borer, just to give you an example, they plant desmodium amongst the maize, which makes it less attractive. It's a small lucerne-like plant that fixes nitrogen as an added bonus. and they plant napier grass around the edge. And napier grass is attractive to the borers and they'll lay their eggs on it, but the larvae can't survive there. So that you're pushing the maize borers away from the maize, attracting them into the napier grass, and there all the larvae die because of the sap. At the same time with cattle, you've got repellents that can be made. There's an animal called the waterbuck. I couldn't get hold of a photo of a waterbuck quickly enough today. But the odour of the waterbuck is repellent to insects, including the tsetse fly. So they put waterbuck odour on collars with the cattle, and then they design traps which have the odour of cattle, which pull the tsetse flies towards them. They land on them, there is insecticide concentrated there, and they die. So these push-pull systems work by understanding insect behaviour and using it to protect the crops. So a little bit in general about insect behaviour. Insects don't just bumble around and bounce into the things that they use. They're often very specific. There are plants that they use. There are parts of plants that they use. They are also often very specific. If they're a pest of animals, if they're feeding on animals, they can be very selective. But the things that they're looking for are not evenly distributed in nature. They tend to be together in patches. If you think of wild plants, they're very often similar plants are drawn together. They're there in communities, or woodland is there with a similar woodland tree type. And animals often move around in herds. So insects searching need to make their decisions over different scales. They need to first go to a habitat where they're likely to find what they're looking for, and then to find the individual that they're looking for, and finally to decide if that's what they want to feed on or to lay their eggs upon. So, a patch. It's a term that we often use, and what I've put up there is the technical description of a patch. A relatively homogeneous, non-linear area that differs from its surroundings. This is what I would refer to as a patch is stuff that's surrounded by other stuff. For some reason, they won't accept that as the formal definition, though. And a patch can be of different sizes and relevance. I've got two extreme examples here. Oilseed rape can be grown in big blocks that's there by the hectare and even by the hundreds of hectares. And then on another scale, it can be a little bit of lichen, no bigger than a thumbnail, which different insects are also looking for. So how do insects carry out these searches? Well, like us, they have a range of senses that are available to them. They use olfaction, the sense of odour, and detect compounds with their antennae. They also have vision, though insect vision isn't great over long distances. They're very good at seeing movement with their compound eyes, but they don't often have distinctive long-range images. And then they also have contact chemoreception. And they use taste rather as we do, but with organs that are placed on their mouth parts, around their head, and also on their legs. Don't, for heaven's sake, attempt to read everything that's on this particular slide, but it's just there to give you an example of the complexity of everything that's involved in this. I've worked with crucifers, with brassicas, and this was part of a review that we did of the chemistry of them. And if you look and just look genuinely, you can see there's everything from specialist and generalist butterflies that are feeding and causing damage. There are parasitoids that are attracted and wish to lay their eggs in the larvae. And there are generalists feeding on the roots. And all these things are intermingled. The damage that happens on a plant root changes the chemistry of the plant and the shape of the plant above the soil surface. And these things all interact, and it's a very complicated system, so that very often we're only taking a look at a very small part of it. because basically that's all that we can cope with at the level of having sensible questions and sensible answers. So I'm now going to give you one of those small slices that I've been involved in taking, and do it with an example that any of you who are gardeners will probably be familiar with. The small white butterfly. I've worked on this for a number of years in different forms, and yet in my vegetable patch at home every year, it still pretty much destroys most of the cabbages that I have there. Much to my girlfriend's embarrassment when people ask her, shouldn't I be able to do better? I should, but there's a time and place for everything. So the smaller of them, Pieris rapi, they lay their eggs singly. There's also the large white that lays their eggs in bunches, and that's when you get the big packs of yellow and black larvae that are going all over and hunting as a pack. The larvae of both butterflies, they cause damage to the leaves. They're a big pest in cruciferous crops, so any of the brassicas, cabbage, broccoli, all these things will be attacked by them. And it's partially the direct damage, but it's also the supermarkets and the customers won't accept anything that they've been on because the frass. Basically, they poop all over the place, and it makes it completely unmarketable. The stuff I grow in my garden, I'm prepared to wash it off, but those of you who are gardeners will know what we'll tolerate in what we grow ourselves and what we'll pay for in the supermarket are very different things. So, as mentioned, these are insects which make selections based on the chemistry of the plant. And unlike us, they do a lot of their tasting with their feet. I don't have a point here, but I'll see if I can point there. If you look on the leg of the insect, you will see, oh, thank you. If you look at the legs of the insect, you will see that they're covered with tiny hairs. And the tiny hairs on the insect, when they're walking on the surface, they touch the surface, and that's how they sense the chemical compounds that are there on the leaf surface that make it identifiable as their host plant. So you can actually touch those hairs, and I'll talk about that a little bit later with volatiles, but you can tell when an insect can detect a compound or not, and these are the processes that they use to identify the plants. But what I was wanting to do with my colleagues was look a little bit at how insects make these decisions between plants and in the patch. The young lady here was the master's student that did all the hard work for me and did an excellent job of that. And we wanted to look at how, at the very short scale, how shape and colour interacted with the chemistry of the plants. So we needed to think a little bit about a patch, and we needed to be able to manipulate the patch and do something with the patch. Now, the smallest patch that you can have is one plant. But one plant's one plant. You can't do an awful lot with one plant. So what we did was we worked in groups of nine plants, and we had three different sorts, and we either put them all together or we put it so that each of three different plants was represented in the group. So we've got the same density of plants, which was nine. We've got the same density of the three different plants, three of each, but we arranged them slightly differently so that they were all tied together or that they were all distributed in all the groups. And we did this in a turntable, which I had at the facility where I was before. And this is because also insects tend to like a place within a room or within a space. For their own reasons, it can be slightly lighter or slightly warmer, but if you just arrange them sitting still, they'll very often have a corner where they like to rest because it's warm, and then they'll pop onto the plant, and whatever you put there, that corner will get chosen. So if you have the plants going round very gently on a turntable, we call it the magic roundabout, that removes that effect of how the plants are placed. And we had our two arrangements, the simple patches and the complex patches. So the first thing that we did was we selected some plants. We had cabbage, we had broccoli, and we had cauliflower. They all look very similar at that stage, but their chemistry is subtly different and their shapes. And then we had some artificial plants. These are plants that had actually been evolved for working with the carrot fly. And though they may look slightly different, that is actually the same surface area as the other ones because of the form in how it's folded. So we had differences of shape that we could offer them. And then we took some of the same shape and we made chemical extracts of the plant and put it so that they could have the same shape but different chemistry. And then we used them in the arrangements. What we found with the plants was, though that there were subtle differences, they were all getting more or less the same amount of eggs, whatever your arrangement was and how they were moving around. So the plants themselves were more or less equal to each other, the broccoli, the cabbage, and the cauliflower. But if we took the chemical extracts of them, then what you can see is you've got a very different result in how it was. And when you had the simple design, where the ones with the same chemistry were all clutched together, the one that they preferred to lay their eggs on was getting a lot more. When you had that they were all spread out, you didn't get it. So the more the plants were clutched together, the more the different chemistry of the plant played a difference. Now, what we believe this is, if you've ever watched the white butterflies, you'll notice that they tend to flutter backwards and forwards over the plants while they're laying the eggs. And when the patch was all the same, they were getting the same message all the time. Whereas when you had the split up patch, they were getting different chemical messages each time they landed. So the more things were the same in the patch, the more it reinforced chemistry. When we took the artificial shapes, we got completely the opposite result. When you had them in the simple patches where all the same models were together in the group, they did have a preference. But when you spread them out, that preference was much more marked. And it was almost that when they were close together, the insects could compare so that they could see with their limited vision those differences only when things were right close together to each other. So what we could conclude from this was that the chemistry of the plant and the shape of the plant are working on different scales. When the chemistry is working, when things are close together, that has a reinforcing effect. Whereas when you have the contrast of them being close together, the insect almost becomes confused. And these things can be very important when you're designing push-pull systems, because it can affect how you want to arrange things in the field in order to get the most effect. But over the years, I haven't limited myself to cabbage. I have spent about 25 years working on pests of cabbage, and I still work on pest cabbage, but I've been encouraged to also develop other interests. And I've also worked on mosquitoes. So what you've got here on the one side in red, you've got a photograph of a mosquito newly emerging from the water where it's grown. And then on the far right, you've got somebody catching adults that are looking for someone to bite. We're all familiar with mosquitoes biting us. I would be very surprised if there is anybody in the room who hasn't been extremely irritated late one night by the buzzing in the ears as something goes round in the room that you're in. What people often think of less is the rest of the light cycle, though at some stage we've probably all seen mosquito larvae squiggling around in small pools, in water butts, or even in quite large bodies of water. So the female mosquito, once she's had a blood meal, normally, lays eggs which can either be single or in big groups, and then you get four larval instars in the water before a pupae, which in a cycle that in warm conditions can only take 2 or 3 weeks, goes through and you get the next generation. There's been a lot of work done over the years on how mosquitoes select what they feed blood off. And because of the irritation factor and because of the vectoring of disease, this is no surprise. What there's been far less work done on is how mosquitoes choose where they lay their eggs. There have been schemes spreading insecticides in water, and we know a lot about which individual species use small wood holes or large muddy ponds, but we don't actually know very much about how they choose the sites where they lay their eggs. Now, I mentioned earlier the hairs on the legs of cabbage butterflies. This is the head of a female mosquito. And on the antennae, you will see lots of long, thin hairs. They use these to detect volatile compounds. Now, I've got a photograph of a colleague of mine in Sweden called Rickard Ignell. He's basically exactly the same as me. We're 2 years different in age, we're the same height, we both have a beard, we both have two children, so we're sort of a mosquito cloning exercise. But Rickard is a very talented sensory physiologist, and he works on how mosquitoes detect the odours, not just of their blood meals, but also the sites where they lay their eggs. Now, there has been some success in this. I don't have the results to say. I only put this talk together very rapidly, so I couldn't chase him to show his results. But there have been successful results. Odours from bacteria that are in the water influence the mosquitoes, and also the odours of the plants that surround the egg-laying sites can influence the mosquitoes. This is work that they've done doing electroantennograms. And this particular work, Rickard's work, was done in Sweden, but similarly there's work done at NRI using this. And what you can do is you can separate the odours that have come from the source, and then you can split the odour so that half of it goes to chemical analysis and half of it goes over the insect's antennae. And basically we can detect the nerve impulses in the insect's antennae so that we know when they're detecting compounds and we can identify the compounds that we're using. So there are results on this, but they're not published yet and they're Rickard's, so I didn't really want to show them today. But there is a part of the work that is mine. Sorry, I do beg your pardon. I say I put this together today. But this is just an illustration of how you get signals off the hair with the different compounds so you can tell whether it's being detected or not. Sorry about that. I'll now go on to my part of what we've been working on. In order to be working on the odours, one of the things that we needed to do was to start characterising the egg-laying sites. So this is work that I've been doing in Ethiopia and working together with a series of new master's students who are doing all the hard work. This lady is called Milda Norruki, and a Latvian who was working with us. So in Ethiopia and down in Arba Meech, which is to the south of Addis Ababa, there are a huge range of different laying sites. In Ethiopia you get two groups of rains. There's a long rainy season and a short rainy season. So there's a lot of water storage, there's a lot of natural water pooling. So you've got a natural water pool there, and there's a picture of an irrigation ditch, which is carrying. And what Milda was doing was characterising some of the sites. So over a period of weeks after the heavy rains, she went round and she started looking at the overposition sites. Now, I mentioned earlier that the larvae and the pupae are in the water. That's where the eggs are usually laid, though they can be laid in the mud on the side. In the water, you've got a range of predators, but you've got the aquatic environment, which can be, as you see, very different. This is an irrigation ditch, relatively clear water, slow moving. But then they also use things like tire tracks at the sides of roads, very temporary water sources. And we count what's in there by using a dipper. This is basically variance on a label. And getting it right is tricky, and people like Gay Gibson, who works over the road, is an absolute expert on the technique of doing it. If you do it wrong, the larvae will rush away and will go and hide on the bottom. If you do it right, you get an indication of the larvae that are in the water. So what Mildred did was, round the town in Arbourminch, characterise nearly 70 sites according to how they were, what cropland was around them, and the water. She took in samples and took it back to the laboratories and did some quite extensive analysis. Some of these things she did on site, she had a pH meter, she looked at dissolved oxygen, because if you take it back to the lab, the dissolved oxygen will change radically on the way. But she also looked at the different ions that were in the water, the total hardness, how much chlorophyll there was in the water, the turbidity, how muddy it was, and the salinity. So she did over 70 sites, and there were a lot of results that came out of this, but she did a lot of work. But the main one that came on, the factor that most decided how many larvae there were in water was its conductivity. Not individual ions, but the total ionic load of the water. And I don't know how well this shows up, but you can see that there are nice lines there with a very significant result. So that was the first go that we had there. And that was Milder. I then managed to find two young men who were also interested in going into Ethiopia and doing a large project, also at Arbourminch. They selected sites around two lakes, and here they didn't just look at the water chemistry and the surroundings, but they looked very much at what was within a circle of 0 to 10 metres from the egg-laying site, and what was within 100 metres of the egg-laying site. So these sites, as I mentioned earlier, they can be very different. This is an artificial irrigation ditch. It's got a fair amount of vegetation growing along the side of it, but there's mosquito larvae found in there. They're also found on the natural sites on the little flood banks that you have around rivers. But they also are often found in artificial construction sites, places like the mud tracks that you have with the tire tracks on the edge. This is a building site, and here they are. Well, you can't see them here, obviously, but they were found here in the muddy water that had been created where the builders had been working. As well as looking at the actual individual sites, as I said, they also classified what was round the sites. Was it agricultural land? They also looked at all the individual crops that were being grown within 100 metres, measured and counted that. They looked at whether it was pasture land. They also counted all the individual animals within 100 metres, but we found that was a very bad measure because they come and go, whereas the area of land is constant, and whether it's pasture or not is constant. So they had all the figures on all the animals, but then we found out it was very difficult to use because they move them vast distances in very short periods. And they also looked at settlements where there's very little in the way and there's an awful lot of beaten earth. We gathered an awful lot of data. And the character that you see at the bottom is a statistical modeller that I work with. He's actually an Australian veterinary surgeon who decided he liked working more with modelling and with environmental questions than he did with operating on animals. What came out of the results that the two lads had collected was if you look at the two basic types of mosquitoes, the anophelines that are here in red, which are the vector mosquitoes, and the culex, which they do vector disease, but they're not malaria vectors, then the deeper the water got, the less likely you were to catch anopheline mosquitoes. Whereas the culex, it didn't matter how deep the water was. So basically, what we were finding was that the anophelines were liking really shallow water and were using really shallow water. When you looked at another aspect, another thing that fell out was how much vegetation there was along the side of a watercourse. Not the actual water itself, but how many plants were growing and how big the plants were that were growing. So the more dense the vegetation across the edge of the egg laying sites, the less it became for both species. And these are the sort of things that when you're beginning to plan management and looking at how you use the land, these can be very important. We don't know whether this is because of predation or because of the effect that shade has, that it's keeping the water cool when the sun is intense. We haven't come that far, to be honest. These results are only just being analysed now, and I'll be meeting with Matt again before Christmas to see how far we can come with that. Right. I've ended up a little short, I'm afraid. I didn't have the chance to practice this talk because I was only confirmed to do it this morning. The picture that you've got here is also students who were collecting adults in maize fields, which came as an incidental study that we found that they were using the maize fields as resting sites. So basically, when we were looking for pests and parasitoids of the maize, we also found that they were full of adult mosquitoes who loved to be resting in maize. Thank you for your time. I apologise for falling a little short of the 40 minutes I was asked to, but I welcome any questions and discussions that you have.